Hello. I hope you're doing well. It's Paul, aka insert YouTube channel here, and welcome to another episode of the FM radio podcast. Sorry about that. I'm getting the two projects mixed up, starting to cross the streams, like Venkman. I think it was Venkman warned not to do. Speaking of which, I hope you get to check out the podcast. Thanks to those of you out there who do, loyal listeners. It's a chance for me to speak my mind unadulterated, sometimes in a PG fashion, sometimes not, most times not. And a chance for me to unload everything that my brain has been eating. So you can check it out. Links always in the description here. Yeah, you can check it out on my website, ephemeralriff.com, which is it's not a commercial website. I don't run a business. And the podcast will always be a non-commercial, non-profit project of mine, because I'm a firm believer that not everything we do has to have some kind of monetary gain tied to it. I think that's a big problem, just like this video. I don't have any ads running on this video. I think it would kind of be very hypocritical. In a way, probably not. But I thought, why not do it, at least for this video. So, enough of the shameless plug. I hope you're doing well. I hope life is treating you well. I hope that some of the other humans that you have to, come in contact with are treating you well. I hope you are treating you well. What you're eating, what you're doing, your mind, body, all that. And if, for whatever reason you're going through something, difficult, I hope that you can make quick work of it and get through it, as fast as possible. And I like to think that there is a light at the end of the tunnel, for all these little moments that we go through, and that the light isn't an oncoming train, Okay, so Anarchist Bookshop Hall. It's kind of funny to be doing this video for a couple reasons. Number one, just to be doing this video on YouTube, period. It's kind of one of those weird kind of existential things when you think about it, I don't want to get, come off like I'm talking about myself. Number two, it's kind of weird to be doing this video because while I did get into exploring anarchism back in the early 2000s, I kind of got away from it. When my wife and I, we had our son, and I found YouTube, working at different jobs, and my whole search for, meaning for self, trying to understand this world. This fucked up world that we live in, that kind of went to the wayside because my focus became family and then YouTube. And there's only so many things you can focus on. And you're probably wondering why I'm more vocal, maybe more political in certain videos, speaking my mind, maybe seem like a shock to you, because this is who I am. I have some strong convictions, things I believe in. And you know, I just, with some things settling down and in a good way, in regards to just life in general, I'm able to, you know, get back, finding my roots, what I kind of believe in, what I stand up for, things I've kind of forgotten about. And so here we are. And I'm going to show you some of the books that I picked up from the Wooden Shoe bookshop. We'll get to these later. You've probably already seen the Caucasian Americans workbook. I'm glad that most of you, or most folks, got the gist of that book in that video. Maybe you got a chance to pick it up, you know, for yourself or for someone. It's very funny. We'll explore that book a little bit more. But before we get into the purpose of this video, I want to explain a little bit about anarchism, as far as why I got into it. Now, I am going to do a video about anarchism and talk about it in 2018, early part of the year. So I'm not going to have any kind of discussion about anarchism. But I will say this about anarchism, capitalism, socialism, communism, any kind of ism, really. Keep this in mind. There's two things you need to keep in mind. Number one, the systems don't run by themselves. They need us to run them. Which takes me to my second point. The systems, the computers, anything man-made are only going to be as good as we fallible humans that run them. We are all, you know, none of us are infallible. We are all imperfect, and so are our systems. Just because a group of people, humans, ran a communist system a certain way, and it failed or it involved a lot of deaths, and it's no different than humans that run the capitalist system, and possibly an anarchism-based system. So, you know, there is no perfect system. I don't think there ever will be. I mean, this is a topic that we can probably explore, and I kind of delve into in my podcast a little bit from time to time. There is no one-size-fits-all. I am a supporter of anarchism. But what does an anarchist or anarchism-based society look like? No one really knows. I would like to direct you to Noam Chomsky. Check out his videos. He's probably the leading authority around today that can speak more eloquently and more knowledgeable about it than I ever could. But it's basically a philosophy about disassembling. And you can apply it to a lot of things, not just a political system or an economic system. So that's all I really want to get into. So if you see anyone commenting or, you know, well, you know, look at, communism failed. Well, no system is going to be perfect because it's run by us. You know, we're not like, we got to stop putting human beings up on some kind of pedestal. Like we came out of the heavens to Earth, like we're our own species or something. So, all right, now I'm going to just basically talk a little bit, share with you how I get into anarchism in the first place. You know, maybe delve into, you know, why and all that. So some of you may have heard some of the things I'm going to say, but this is in case you're kind of new here, either to the channel or just stumbling on this video of mine. So I grew up in the 70s in the suburbs west of Philadelphia, and to a middle-class family. Dad worked, mom didn't have to, and went to Catholic school, and around fifth grade started to disagree with Catholicism, started to check out mentally, even though I still had to go to school. Left home when I was 18. It was a very, very tumultuous period of my life, 16 to 18. Going through a lot. You know, some angst there with my parents, but all that is cool now. Lucky to say, not trying to brag or anything, because I know some folks out there don't have a good relationship with their parents, but and you know, so in my, you know, left home, got a job, moved into the city of Philadelphia, Center City to be exact. Lived in a lot of different apartments. Lived in one apartment that had had roaches. You know, I exaggerate and I say roach infested, but it had its share of roaches. And there was even one moment when a homeless guy defecated within the front doors of the apartment building. So, yeah, great times. And that was when this white kid, this suburban-raised white kid who only ever saw a black person either on TV, you know, Sanford and Son, Cosby Show, What's Happening, or when I would go occasionally into the city. I only ever saw one black kid in my Catholic school, and one Asian kid too. It's predominantly white. So that was a big eye-opener, seeing people from other cultures, lifestyles. And it was great. And I saw a lot of homeless people, black and white, mostly black. And that was another eye-opener. But it wasn't until moving out of the city, back to the burbs, meeting my wife around the early 2000s, is when I started to delve, and I found out about anarchism. Now, how did I, come to find out about it? I really didn't even know about it. I didn't know about wooden shoe books when I was living in the city back in the 90s. I don't even know if it was still around, or it was around at that point. But I hit my 30s, met my wife, and I was just very unsatisfied, unhappy with working these dead-end jobs. You know, for the man, I wanted to do something creative with my life. And I was, there was the internet, came around the early 2000s or whatever. And I don't know, I started searching for, I have no idea what was the gateway. But I started searching to philosophy and nihilism. And then from nihilism, I think, I found my way to anarchism. And I always had that misconception of, like a lot, most people do, when you say any kind of word with the root of anarchy, you think, violence, chaos, disorder, people thrown, people in balaclavas thrown Molotov cocktails at buildings. that's not what, that's anarchy, kind of. But that's not what anarchism is. Anarchism is a philosophy, and I'm not going to, like I said, get into it. I'm going to do a whole other video. Now, you can, I'm sure you got Google at your fingertips. I will say this. The people probably living as close to an anarchist, anarchism-based society are probably the indigenous people in this world, like the uncontacted tribe living in the Amazon, I think it is, or even the Native American, I should say indigenous people of North America, Native American Indians, how they lived before the white man showed up and, you know, committed genocide. They probably lived in a anarchism-based, you know, classless-based, you know, maybe communist, who knows. I will say one more thing about anarchism. It's basically about us, you know, having, there is no one at the top. No queen, no king, no queen, you know, no ruling class. You know, we make the decisions, you know, we're in control. It's, you would probably say, it's we the people, you know? I've heard that somewhere, we the people. Some kind of fiction, work of fiction, or some kind of book that was written back in 1776 or something. A couple of white slave owners had an idea or something. It's pretty funny. Yeah, it's pretty, I think it's kind of a fantasy story or something. So I found out about anarchism, and I started to just soak it up, devour it. I wanted to know, you know, what is this? This is really something that I can relate to. It really resonates with me, the definition and the meaning. There's a lot to anarchism. It's there's no like little doctrine. It's not like the Ten Commandments. It's not like, you know, capitalism at all. It's kind of complicated, but again, that's, get into that into another video. And from there, I started to do more research. I found about a place called the A Space. It was a building located in Philadelphia. I think like Southwest, West Philly, where just a space, not mostly for people related to anarchism, anarchists, I guess you would say. They would have show films there and things like that. And we went there once or twice and got a chance to meet some really good people. And then from there, ended up going to finding out about the Wooden Shoe Books. And this was all back around 2004, 2005. And walking there, and it was just a plethora of books and information. And it was at a previous location, the bookstore. They've since relocated to their current spot on South Street directly. And then that was it. You know, I kind of, I go on these little journeys of mine where I need to find out and absorb all the details about this thing, whether it's getting into macro photography and photographing insects. That was a, used to spend hours on the weekends photographing bugs. And it never turned out to be anything. I enjoyed it. It was great, but that kind of died down. Same thing with anarchism. You know, what is this? You know, I just poured over it and devoured it. And I kind of had my fill. And life moved on. I moved on. We had a kid and had to focus on jobs and healthcare and daycare and the stress of you know, living in an apartment, wanting to get a house and all that, and you know, kind of moved away from a lot of that. And fast forward to, I think it was October of 2017. This year, well, depending on when you watch this video, I guess. And like I said, I'm back to finding my roots again. That point, it was like a turning point a little bit in my life. You know, a lot of the things, my own personal philosophy started to come back to me. You know, and I started to think about anarchism again. And I was like, man, you know, it's been like 5 years or so since I was down at Wooden Shoe Books. I wonder if it's still there. It's still there. I said, you know, let me take a trip. I took a trip. It was great to see the place still there, to see all the books and the zines and all the different reading materials and the pamphlets, and they have some records now. And kind of that flame kind of rekindled a little bit. And it's been back in my consciousness a little bit now, over the last couple months. And it feels good. It feels good to be back in touch with that very, to me, it feels like a very natural mindset, what anarchism is all about. But, you know, putting it into practice, it's kind of a little different. I hope that kind of gives you a little bit of a background. You know, my getting into anarchism was a bit of a soul-searching kind of thing, because I am still fed up with a lot of these systems, capitalism. And it's not so much the systems. It is, you know, partially. It's also the people. You know, the systems don't run themselves. A gun doesn't shoot itself. A Bible doesn't, you know, read itself. It's the people. And there's, you know, a lot of us humans, not you, not me necessarily, but just humans in general, greedy, lazy, easily corrupted. You know, I can go on and on. There's a litany of things, probably as long as the list of side effects on any, you know, pharmaceutical drug. You know, seems like the bad side of us seems to outweigh the good that we're capable of. So it resonates with me still. And, you know, I was looking for answers. So if you're looking for answers to this world and you don't like what you see, check out anarchism. It might find that it resonates with you, you know. So, Wooden Shoe Books. I'm going to go through the books that I picked up. I wanted to support the place, support a lot of the independent people, show you what you might find at an anarchist bookshop. Now, there's no real like directory, I don't think. You might, you know, search for info shop, independent bookstore. I don't know really how you might go about finding a bookstore like this in your area, if one exists. If you're able to get to Philadelphia, Center City, Philadelphia, check out Wooden Shoe Books. I'll show you a picture here, but the volunteers who work there allowed me to take some inside pictures of the shop. So if you go to my website and go to photography, you'll find those photos on my Flickr page. And the bookstore carries a wide range of things. Periodicals, newsletters, zines. Zines are like someone like me would take letters and get them published into a little book. You'll find children's books. You'll find books about feminism. I think maybe philosophy. A lot of those, you know, feminism, political kind of books. And you'll even find books like about bicycling and gardening and things like that. So, but you'll find also a lot of radical literature as well. You don't walk in there and get assaulted by people wearing balaclavas and, you know, hey, we're going to meet down by the docks and we're going to destroy this, you know, set fire to this bank. It's not like that. Are there people like that? Of course. There's lots of extreme. You know, this is, again, I don't want to get too much into this particular tangent, but there's extreme behaviors. Every system, every culture. So it's not, you know, you've seen it. Good cops, bad cops. Good priests, bad priests. Everyday people. You know, we're human. We're fallible. We're godless animals. That's all there is to it. You know, we're born out of the chaos. So, but yeah, and people were friendly. You know, chat with them. They're just like anybody else. You know, there's nobody putting on airs, nothing like that. They're like, hey, welcome to the shoe. You know, first time here, anything we can help you with. And, but a ton of books and a lot of books that you know, books you may find on Amazon, but probably not a lot of books that you'll find at like, Borders, you know. And they have children's books, but a lot of that children's books, not like Dr. Seuss or The Giving Tree, but a lot of non-mainstream children's books. Very authentic kind of children's books. Speaking of which, we're going to go ahead and start taking a look at some of the books, just in case you never get a chance to go to an info shop or an anarchist bookshop. I'll show you some of the books I picked up. Mostly zines. Because I'm kind of drawn to stuff that's artistic or creative. There's a ton of books on, I know, political. I mean, you'll find things. Yeah, I just can't go and spend $1,000 and bring home all kinds of real, you know, textbooks that I'm never going to read. So, you know, I kind of kept it down to stuff that I could read. Anyway, here's a book. It's called All My Friends Are Dead. Have you ever laughed and cried at the same time? All My Friends Are Dead is both the saddest funny book and the funniest sad book you'll ever read. Here, in accessible cartoon form, are the amusing existential predicaments of clowns, cassette tapes, dinosaurs, zombies, snowmen, houseplants, and others as they face the inevitable. All My Friends Are Dead. Can't really, is there copyright on this? No part of this book may be reproduced in any form. I'm just going to give you a little sneak peek. Please stop buying my friends if you are just going to slowly kill them. So, you know, you find this at the Anarchist Bookshop. It's not all like just constantly, you know, raging against the machine, you know, or, you know, bah humbug type of, you know, mentality. It's everyday people, you know. It's all people from walks of life who are, you know, believe in anarchism, you know. So, but anyway. Pretty cool book. I'm not sure if you probably could get this on Amazon, but I'm not sure if you would find this in like a Barnes & Noble. There's a couple of zines, actually. Rad Dad. The Sharpest Lives. But we have this one here. And a zine is a self-published book. It can be about anything. Political, you know, more in the fantasy, comic kind of thing, but with a maybe political edge to it. You're not going to find, like, just generic superhero stuff. There's usually something regarding politics, anarchism, gender-related, you know? Just a lot. Sorry, it's late at night when I'm recording this, so... Not that I'm sharp as a tack to begin with. We have on, it's called Goodbye or The State of Nature, a comic by Ben Passmore. Published by Silver Sprocket. But it's a little, little comic book with a... show you there. I don't want to show you too much because I don't have permission. But I'm not really here to review each one of these and or give a review. All right. So many zines, but this is the great stuff. This is one of the great things about anarchist bookshops or info shops, however you want to call it. Power to the people right here. It's true. You know, this is what it's about. Being able to, you know, bring your stuff to life out in the world without having to rely on a major publisher. That's probably stuff that you can get into and talk about now. You know, these folks aren't going to make, you know, money like Stephen King money or whoever else, you know, the Harry Potter. You know, it's not mainstream. So when you're not doing mainstream, you're going to struggle to make a living, which, you know, isn't fair. Anyway, here's one called The Sharpest Lives. That's a graphic novel by Anna Cuvo. When Asha Durante is orphaned, she is left to rough the post-apocalyptic mutant infiltrated landscape of New York City with her roommate Evie. Then they meet a unique band of creatures in a nightclub, and their lives are never the same. Sharpest Lives is the first installation in a series meant to question traditional religious beliefs and their impact on racism, feminism, and other politics. So there you go. It was written and illustrated by a young 21-year-old, living in Bethlehem, PA. It's pretty cool. And I'll just give you a little glimpse here, real quick. Without, you know, don't really have permission to show the contents. Not that it's ever stopped me before, but this is a little different here. But yeah, it's two roommates and... Yeah, I'm not going to spoil it for you. You'll have to check it out and read it for yourself if you're interested. Rad Dad. There you go. And I'm assuming this is somewhat of a... perhaps representation of the guy and his family behind this book. It's another zine. And this one happens to be stories of from parents about parenthood. A different kind of stories of different situations. Adoption, daycare. It's all mostly text. There's no illustrations. And we have here do a little reading here. Welcome to Rad Dad 24. Pass it on. I'm a bit stunned at the emotional intensity of this new issue. It's beautiful stories about adoption as told from the birth mother's perspective, powerful and loving confessions on becoming a single father, the challenges of being a stepfather, and mourning a miscarriage. And of course, there are, as usual, the sometimes painful, but always honest reflections about parenting in general. I hope you enjoy. And then he goes on to talk a little bit about whether or not he's going to be able to continue Rad Dad for different reasons. He would like to actually turn into a full-fledged magazine with employees and such. But again, another kind of zine that you would find. Good stuff. It was really good stories too. It's great to just know that there are people out there that have something to share, something to offer more than what the mainstream has to offer. There's more stories out there than just just the Stephen King and the Harry Potter, you know, than just the films that we watch on Netflix, the TV shows that we watch, the people that we interact with, if we interact with our neighbors at all. So it's a great way to maybe even get inspired, you know. Here is Animalus. Give you a quick little glimpse here. This one is black and white. It's illustrated in pencil, written, and it a little bit of a perspective, a story told if humans were treated same way as cattle. So unique. And something I actually thought about myself. So it was kind of neat to actually see someone talk about that. So it's kind of politically based about how we treat, you know, animals and such. So this person, I think, is definitely somewhat of a animal rights, maybe an activist or something like that. Don't really know. But yeah, another great zine. Here is another zine called Moth Milk. Moth Milk Zines. And very personal stories here. I don't really want to show too much from this one. Moth Milk is a collective experiment in queer storytelling as a means of healing. What began as a personal zine has grown into a broad exchange of writing, art, and photography across geographical and generational lines. Moth Milk is created by and for those of us who deviate from the mythical norm of white, CIS hetero, able-bodied folks, exploring what it means to exist and resist in a society that wasn't built for us. And there's truth to that. The guiding idea of this zine has three branches: authentic, non-tragic, and non-tokenizing narratives from queer and otherwise marginalized people are hard to find. Publishing is generally seen as something only people with money, time, and resources are able to do. And it's truth. Zines like this allow all of us to legitimize our stories and thoughts on a larger scale than might be otherwise possible. The environment and culture that gets created when people can share their stories with each other is potent for healing and justice on individual and broader levels. Zines rule. An accessible DIY means of learning, sharing, and purging our demons. Sweet. So it's been over a year since this person has been doing this zine. She just kind of shares a little information about that. But this one is another glimpse into just everyday people and how they feel. And, you know, what they express through poetry, through illustrations, photography. I mean, these are people. This is legitimate. There are people out in the world who are not the status quo that we see every day on TV and the ads. You know, there's a lot of people who just, for whatever reason, you know, have gone through what they've gone through. And they are legitimate. And their feelings and their everything, you know, is valid. Here's another one called No Gods, No Dungeon Masters. Kind of sound that I like. I don't know about you. Let's see. So this inside the cover here, where they have like you would find the copyright and such. Another Silver Sprocket, which I think is a publishing house. So there's a little Creative Commons thing. So this is, you can't use this or reproduce it for commercial reasons. You can share as long as you give credit back. It says, money is bad, so is everything. Licensed under a Creative Commons Attribution Non-Commercial Share Alike 4.0 International License. But who fucking cares? We're all gonna die anyway. Fucking love it. So this is a little bit of a interesting little based around Dungeons and Dragons. A few folks from different walks of life getting together to play a game, and here's just kind of one of the scenes. Shows you how it's illustrated. You know. So that was a good read. We have this little collection of postcards. It's called Slingshot. This is actually a scratchboard illustrations, disguised as a book of innocent postcards. Slingshot is a dangerous collection of Eric Drucker's most notorious posters. I'm not really familiar. I probably should be ashamed to say this, I guess. I should maybe know. I always feel like whenever they say, you know, this is a collection of somebody's great works, and I don't know that person, I feel like, man, I should know who that person is, but I don't. Eric Drucker, plastered on brick walls from New York to Berlin, tattooed on bodies from Kansas to Mexico City, Drucker's graphics continue to infiltrate and inflame the body politic. So just give you a little example of his works. So pretty really good stuff, really good scratch art. I believe it's all scratch art. I think he even says that. Take a look. I thought I saw, yeah, all images drawn with razor blade on scratchboard. Scratchboard is basically like this black, it's white underneath, a black coating on top. You scratch away the black, and that's how you make this drawing. You're basically scratching the black away to reveal the dress. So, something else you can find there. I'm not sure if this is something that you would find at Barnes & Noble's. You know, maybe Amazon, more likely. Just because Amazon, you know, anyone can almost sign up and sell stuff. For the most part, it depends, but here's a periodical by Fifth Estate. And see if they talk a little bit about this. Fifth Estate. The Fifth Estate is an anti-profit anarchist project published by a volunteer collective of friends and comrades. FifthEstate.org. No ads, no copyright. So, and it's a lot of letters and articles written about a lot of different things. Punk and anarchy. Anarchist filmmakers, video tape gorillas, and digital ninjas. You can see right here, anarchy in solidarity, in action, fighting fascists, closing prisons. So probably more on the radical side. But, you know, these are people. They're legitimate. They have a voice. And I'm all about closing prisons. I don't really support any kind of extreme behavior in regards to when it comes to violence. But with that being said, I've been paying my taxes to this country, right? And what does this country do with a lot of our tax money? It takes our kids, our families, sends them off to a war, different wars that we don't really have a say about as whether or not we should be involved in. A lot of them end up getting killed. And that's something that, you know, a lot of people, and I'm saying this because there's people going to think that all anarchists are, that's all we want, that's all people want is violence or whatever. And it's not true. There are people who are not anarchists that riot after sports games. I haven't seen too many lately, but back in the mid-2000s, I mean, up here in my own home state of Pennsylvania, there was white people. Well, probably a mix, white and black, but there's a lot of riots with the Penn State, that whole area. The college kids would riot. There was a riot in regards to something at one point, and they won a game or something. And how about all the riots from the soccer fans over in whatever, Brazil or Europe? So our species, no matter what group it is, there's always, you know, bad seeds. So there's no, you know, there are no saints. There's no perfect system here. And that's not saying, I'm trying to avoid where my mind goes, wants to go. And I want to get into, you know, violence. Is violence right? Should you, you know, here's what I'm going to say about Antifa and any violence that they do. And what people might think about it. I don't support violence. If our government can go to war, right, with another country for whatever reason, then don't Antifa or terrorists have the right to go to war as well? It's good for the goose, good for the gander, right? Or no, it's only good for what we deem is morally justifiable, right? I'm not condoning violence, okay? It's just something to think about. And you step back a little bit and look at things. You start to see the forest for the trees. All right, the last book I picked up, I did a whole video about this. Basic Skills, Caucasian Americans Workbook. It's kind of a satirical, you know, parody piece, but some truth to it. About life here in the United States and how mostly weird it has been and is. But they have a lot of fun little, it's like a workbook that you might get at school. So they have sort of, you know, seek and finds and little problems and answer the questions and research questions and at the end of each chapter and all that. So there you have it. I hope you found this at least, you know, somewhat relaxing, maybe informative. If you're an anarchist, I could say a fellow anarchist, I guess. I'm not an anarchist in the strictest sense. You know, I support anarchism. You know, I tried to practice or live or perform practical anarchy when I can. You know, but you know, I'm born into this capitalist system, like most of us, you know, here in the United States at least. I wasn't taught. My family wasn't farmers. We wouldn't know how to hunt. You put us out in the woods. Most of us, you know, living in this capitalist system, you put us out in the woods, we'd all be dead in a week from starvation. We don't know how to hunt or forage, you know, and those are important things. That's what makes us human, hunting and foraging. That's why we have these things and those legs. So I'll get into all that, but that's something I often bring up again on my podcast. And stay tuned for that full video on anarchism itself sometime in 2018. Until then, thanks for watching. Wish you all my best as you travel down your own path in life, trying to make sense of this world that doesn't really make much sense, much less the people in it that run it. All right, take care, and hopefully see you another see you another video, or talk to you in the podcast. Take care.